Welcome to part two of the Right On Christmas Special 2023.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy
Moving along, right, A Blanket, A Christmas Story by Mary Hodson.
The package, a gift from America, found its way to our doorstep just in time for the inaugural Christmas in our new home. Excitement buzzed through our house to our home, not only for the festivity, but also for the imminent arrival of our firstborn, due in a few months. The parcel adorned in glossy brown paper with secure edges, proudly displayed distinctive American stamps, stars and stripes, marking its origin in North Dakota, a northern state where some of our ancestors had settled following the wave of immigration from our homeland in the late 1800s and early 1900s. In the 1901 census, our ancestral home housed 13 residents, daughters Margaret, Mary, Kate, and Honora, and sons Thomas, James, John, William, and Andrew. The household, a testament to the era's Irish family structure, also included Catherine, the sister of the head of the household. Mary and Kate, accompanied by their brothers William and James, would later embark on the journey to the United States, seeking out a better life, leaving behind their family and their ancestral home. Kate met her life partner, an American, in Boston, and subsequently settled in North Dakota. This was a black period in Irish history. The after effects of the Great Famine was still evident. Between 1845 and 1851, 1 million immigrated, while a further 1 million died. Ireland at that time lost a quarter of its population during those terrible years. It has been estimated that over 6 million Irish people have immigrated to America since 1920. The west coast of Ireland being the worst affected. In Mayo, the population declined from 388,887 in 1841 to 274,830 in 1851. Immigration to North America in particular was seen as an opportunity to support families back home and to improve the life of the immigrant. A distinguishing feature of this immigration period between 1856 and 1921 was the large number of young single women who immigrated to the United States. In the years 1886 to 1905, the ratio of male to female was 175 to 100. A startling statistic demonstrates the continued effects of mass immigration. Mayo had a population of 389,000 in 1841, while in 1991, the population had reduced to 110,000. As a child, our father shared tales of his aunts and uncles who undertook this significant migration, tinged with a touch of sadness for those who never returned. The Yanks, as they were affectionately called, became mythical figures in our family narrative. Their stories conveyed with love, affection, and a hint of wonder. Despite the geographical distance, the stories of those American immigrants, those Irish immigrants in America lingered in our hearts. The Christmas parcel, a connection to those early immigrants, arrived from Kate's direct descendants. One day, an airmail letter bearing the unmistakable American stamp and script arrived on our parents' doorstep. It was from Harry, Kate's son, who sought to reconnect with his Irish family, particularly his first cousin, our father, Andrew. In 1969, 60 years after Cade's immigration, Harry and his American wife Doherty visited the ancestral home. The excitement was palpable as they unveiled the letter found hidden behind a picture following the death of his mother, Kate. The letter offered details, names and addresses of her family in Ireland, and a vivid description of her life at the home place. She had never shared this information during her lifetime with her American family. The immigration experience was fraught with challenges and sometimes compelled Irish immigrants to conceal their identity, even altering their surnames to evade discrimination in the post-famine United States. Kate, influenced by her brothers, changed her Irish surname, guarding her Irish heritage to protect her family. Harry's emotional reunion with his cousin and his large Irish family in the ancestral home was marked by stories, tears, and laughter. They retraced the footsteps of their ancestors down the bog road, exploring the derelict stone cottages that once housed a community in Carna, now known as Carna. The connection between our families endured, with Harry and Doherty expressing a particular interest in me, the eldest of nine. Their offer to bring me to Dakota for education was seen as a gesture of assistance, was ultimately declined. Over the years, our family stayed in touch, and in 1977, that special parcel arrived to mark my first Christmas as a married couple. A beautiful green hand-crocheted baby blanket was enclosed, later used to swaddle our son.
This heirloom had passed down through generations 17 years ago. Our grandson was swaddled in the same blanket. It serves as a poignant reminder of our immigrant roots. Each Christmas, a handcrafted Merry Christmas decoration, a gift from Doherty, Harry's wife, adorns the window next to the Christmas tree. The story of our ancestors' immigration is retold each year at Christmas to the next generation. President Mary McAleese's words echo, encapsulating the immigrant's heart that beats to the rhythm of two different worlds, forging a bridge between the old and the new, a bridge strengthened by stories, memories, and the enduring thread of family connections.
Thank you.
Very good.
Well done, Mary.
I remember that blanket, Mary. I have a total picture in my head of it.
Beautiful story.
Yeah. Oh, lovely family history.
You see the connection going on.
Yeah.
Continued on.
Yeah.
Lovely, Mary. I can identify with an awful lot about people immigrating and the stories. And when they come back then to Ireland, an awful lot of them used to boast of what they had and what they didn't. I think a lot of them exaggerated.
Yeah.
Well, not all, but they had interesting stories.
Thanks, Kathleen.
They were very brave, and it was very sad at the same time to have to leave your own country.
That's for sure. Yeah.
It occurs to me that I haven't given Grit much chance to say anything. Grit, do you want to say anything?
I'm just out in the storm and I listened to the story. It is amazing. Even though I wasn't forced to immigrate, I'm in a different country, and every year I'm looking forward to the parcels from Germany.
Yes, of course.
That's lovely, Grit.
Yeah. Hopefully they'll arrive safely.
Yeah.
Okay. Is James there? James? Yes. You said that right. James, we're coming on to your second poem now.
Yes.
And, we're going to share that now. And this one is called The Music of Winter. James, I think I've read it. Sorry, I was going to ask you to read it, but I think I have the voice done on it. Okay, this is a poem by James Conway, The Music of Winter.
The Music of Winter by James Conway. Across cobblestones the cartwheels splinter into sparks of diamonds. Hawked sound spins as old wheels slide on, greased by the palm of time. Glass ice, too, wants its hold, glistening, arguing with balance, the wheeze within struggling, circling as temperatures drop, and above the turf-lined city, tunes relish in the black of porter and oak chested whiskey prompts even the lamest singer to latch onto the magic invested in accordions frenched by the cutting of the wind on sawdust. Enemy dances with enemy as hatred shrinks into nothing. The notes now are rising this Christmas, a truce before any hint of a blood-spilling rage. In all the mystique of distance, blue flame cavorts with angelic yellows and reds, richer than summer's ripest apple, adds to the heat of an evening ignited by humanity's coming together on an evening lasting near the outskirts of forever, chiming with the yawning of the dawn, and again the music of winter rings out a bell alone.
Have another look. There's plenty of sawdust in that picture, the last one.
No shortage, Frank.
No shortage. Well done, James. That's where all the sawdust from the previous one ended up on this poem. You know, that's
why. I think the second poem got the major percentage of the sawdust.
It's very good, James. Lots of dancing in your poetry, James.
Well, yes, I thought dancing was pacifying.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
it brings people together. So.
Thank you.
You really capture the winter atmosphere there. It's very, very good.
Yeah, well, I enjoy the Christmas poems and hopefully they go down well. So it's something to aim towards, and bringing the piece Enemy Dancing with Enemy, I think, is important.
Yeah.
I think last year we had that story about the soccer match that took place on Christmas Day in Germany.
Oh, yes.
First World War between the British soldiers and the German soldiers. We had that. Was that from you, Jutta? No, it was from Nollaig, I think.
It was from Nollaig's nephew who wrote it for a school project.
That's right. Okay, well, we have a first now, and you're the first people to see it. It's a new song by Grit Metsch, Good Night by Grit Metsch.
Good Night by Grit Metsch. Song and lyrics, Grit Metsch. Production and mixing, Aidan Guilfoyle, Rainwater Studio, Kilbeggan. Video, Frank Fahey.
My love, now it's time to go to sleep. From the way you look at me, I feel you think the same. The day is done and we did the best we could, but now it's time to dream again. Let the world spin round and round. They don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. Let the world spin round and round. They don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. My love, another dawn is breaking soon, but we stayed up So much to feel, so much to say. Tonight, let me hold you in my arms, I keep you warm. Tonight you are safe. Let the world spin round and round, they don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. Let the world spin round and round, they don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. My love, now it's time to go to sleep. From the way you look at me, feel you think the same. Tonight, let me hold you in my arms, I keep you warm. Tonight we are safe. Let the world spin round and round, they don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. Let the world spin round and round, they don't need us now. No, they don't need us now. Let the spin round and round, they don't need us now. No, they don't need us now.
Absolutely excellent, Gert. Absolutely excellent.
Lovely, Gert. It was
lovely, great.
Yeah. Wonderful song. Very special.
Great words.
Obviously
great
very singing. Meaningful to yourself.
Absolutely. I was my first winter in Kilkenny. It was December and I was sitting there and it's not the only song I wrote about kind of wishing someone was there by my side and could to take care of someone. There's another one coming up that I'm working on still. And it's just the atmosphere, like, you know, you don't feel alone when you sing that song even.
Yeah.
No, it's absolutely lovely.
Yeah.
And you're the first ones, beside the one I was busking it in, I've been busking it in the streets, but you're the first ones to hear the production at all. So it's a premiere.
And Grace, it's a beautiful production as well. Frank has done it proud.
Yeah.
He's put some beautiful pictures and scenes with it.
And
very, very romantic and gentle and tender.
And even though the world was spinning round and round with busyness, this time had stood still.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was great
for this couple.
I was going to say, sorry, James, you wanted to come in there. Sorry, yeah, go ahead.
No, you go ahead, Mary, there.
No, I just wanted to say it. I was sharing with Frank, shared it with me yesterday. I was privileged to hear it yesterday. And I was saying to Frank that has a particular meaning for me of what I read into it this month. Today, actually, by date, my mother died 2 years ago. And my father had died previously, and it's like they were a true love affair, as it were. They went to school together. They had spent their life together, really. And it's like they had reared us and had 27 grandchildren, and since a couple of weeks ago, 42 great grandchildren, like huge legacy left behind. And it's like my mother wanted to go to my father, really. And it's like she was saying, they don't need us now. You know what I mean? Well, we've done our bit. They don't need us now. So I can see that song been used in several different contexts, you know, because it'll mean so much to different people. So I would like personally to congratulate you, Grish. It meant a lot to me, and I certainly would love to be able to have a copy of some of your songs, all of your songs, basically. If you had a CD, I'd pay top dollar for it. But that particular one, and the one we heard earlier, Friends, are both really, really, really excellent pieces of music, and I wish you every success with them. Again, you're top of the charts, as far as I'm concerned.
Congratulations to Grit. Lovely music, and gentle but strong, and very appealing. And I can't see how you couldn't get to the number one in the American charts.
I don't know what's yet to come. I never know. I don't imagine to think that far, but I am so happy with the words you say to me, and it really makes me grateful for the gift that I was given to do such things, and for people to see themselves or their or kind of some situations in these songs, to be able to link and linger and identify themselves. And that's something that is much, much more than any success. It's just what all I want is about. Thank you so much.
Okay, and greet the poem you have on Facebook today. That's lovely too.
All right. Thank you. I'm gonna bring it in.
Do.
Okay, we're going to reflect on Christmas Eve and poetry for a minute before we close with some more music. The first poem is, Elizabeth wasn't expecting this, but we started with Elizabeth. We're winding down with Elizabeth, and this is called Christmas.
O come, O ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come.
Christmas by Elizabeth Hannon. Christmas preparations done, presents wrapped, stockings hung. Quietly out the door I creep, children, Santa dreaming, sleep. Icy roads, car can't make it, breathing foggy steam, I leave it. Moonlight reflects on ice and snow, sliding to midnight mass I go. Strangers, neighbours, climb the hill, cheery greetings from darkness spill. Bright rainbows from church emerge, laughter muffled, all converge. Triumphant organ, voices joining, old familiar carols telling Mary's journey, ages gone, to the place her child was born. The crowds hush, as with candles dim, young girl solemnly the babe takes in. Boy's sweet soprano voice enthralls, O holy night, my heart free falls. Exalted, renewed, I struggle home, ready for the shouts, Santa's come!
Come, O ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, O come ye, O come ye to...
Okay, and followed straight away by James's poem. James, you may or may not remember sending in this one time or other to us. We rarely lose anything. And here it is.
Christmas Eve by James Conway. I remembered those Christmas eves, the candles triangled on the windowsill, a faded teddy bear posing as a melting snowman, and cards in rows lighting up our winter tales. Outside, the ice and snow blued our vision, questions on our children's lips. What would Santa bring? My father with his Mozart, notes sending us to a higher heaven, a universe caught between the stars, the twinkle, sparkle, the cheer, a warm bed for the lucky, but not for those who had little, a stable with the heat of a donkey, straw scattered for a little baby, new amongst the world. The wise men, tired, in awe, glad they'd travelled miles in hundreds across deserts, mountains, led by a light only they could see, knowing a new day was their salvation, the mystique of that feeling, magic to the heart.
Stands the test of time, James.
Thank you very much.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleeping heavenly peace, sleeping heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake sight, glory streams from heaven afar, heavenly hosts sing alleluia, Christ the Savior is born, Christ the Savior is born.
Really lovely. Thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. Do you know the only thing that we haven't included?
What?
Mom's little clown.
Oh, yeah.
The night isn't over yet.
Oh, great.
We're only leading up to the end by bringing down the temperature a bit after all the, excitement.
That was beautiful, Mary Rose.
After all the excitement of boxing matches and everything else, we're just trying to wind down a bit. And Nollaig is still with us, thanks be to God. One of our most favourite Christmas stories of all time. Thanks again, Elizabeth, for mentioning it, is Man's Little Clown by Nollaig. And here it is.
Oh, you were bringing it up. Oh.
Mam's Little Clown by Nollaig O'Donnell. He's just, I don't know, he's just gorgeous, I thought. He's so cute, and I think he's got a real look of Mam in his eyes. What a thought. I mean, I don't think Mam would be too pleased to think that a little clown would remind me of her. Maybe not, but somehow there was, in his absolute eccentricity, a little gem that held something of her essence. I had fallen for him. And so would you, if you saw him. Let me give you the chance. First of all, he was tiny, stocky but tiny, with big feet, yes, very big feet. I think I must have noticed those big, long, red, shiny shoes almost immediately. Immediately, of course, after I had noticed his eyes. Those wonderful, soft, full of divilment eyes. The kind of eyes, well, perhaps those one-of-a-kind of eyes. His cheeks were chubby, made even chubbier by the broad, expansive, truly winning smile. His face had a gentleness about it. Its childlike features, beautifully button-nosed, were surrounded by a chaos of the most amazingly soft, dishevelled red hair. Atop this uncoiffed mess sat his cap, a multicoloured striped cap with a peak. I had the distinct impression that he would not be separated from his cap. It was like his smile, a permanent fixture. He wore an oversized bright red dicky bow pressed up against his chin, accentuating an almost non-existent neck, while at the same time contrasting wonderfully with his deep turquoise shirt. His pants were multicolored, like his cap, and very, very baggy. They were elastic-waisted, though I know not why, because his big red-buttoned braces were more than adequate for the job. His huge, pale, wide-open, welcoming hands beaconed out at the end of outstretched arms. Arms that were short, though not out of proportion in a body that seemed to be entirely proportionate to the little man himself. I was smitten. My decision was made. There would be no two ways about it. He was coming home with me. Mam was sitting by the fire reading the paper that evening when I called. "Welcome home," said Mam. "You're looking well. Great tan." "Oh, thanks," I said. "We got lovely weather. And I have a little something for you." I reached into my shoulder bag for the very special souvenir I had brought for Mam. Though in truth I had absolutely no idea how she would react to it. I just knew that I had to give it to her. "Oh, I told you not to be wasting your money on me," she said. She had always said that, and she had always meant it. Not for Mam the little souvenir of a trip to wherever. No, indeed, she didn't do dust collectors, thank you very much. I was taking a risk with this one. I knew that. "Here you are," I said, handing over a small, soft little package. "Hope you like it." I held my breath as Mam tore off the wrapping paper and unrolled the plastic bubble wrapping before eventually coming face to face with her little clown. I was still holding my breath when Mam smiled. It was the smile that I had longed to see, that sometime smile that started at her lips, lingering there just a few seconds before taking that risk to rise upwards, coming to rest right inside her eyes. She liked him. The week that followed was not an easy one. It was one of those weeks that mark a change, a turning point in the life of a family. A time when everything goes on about its business as usual, yet some one thing has happened that has within it the power to threaten the familiar order of lives. Auntie B, our favourite auntie, had been diagnosed with dementia. I suppose it had felt more like confirmation of a terrible suspicion than a diagnosis. And it rocked our world. There is nothing quite like the confirmation of fear to petrify and dispirit. Towards the end of that particular week, I dropped in on Mam. She was sitting by the fire reading the newspaper. Auntie B had just left after a short visit. She had been in town shopping and called to Mam for a cuppa before going home. She skipped cards again last night, Mam said, as she let a log fall into the fire. She says she felt she had a cold coming on and decided to stay in, but I know she just forgot to go. I know that, I said. You do, and so does she. We fell silent. Do you know something, Mam said? You laugh at this. But last night, I wasn't in the best of form sitting here reading the paper. Then I heard the church bells chime 8 o'clock. I lifted my head from the paper and I looked over at the windowsill, at my little clown. A very strange thing happened. I started to laugh, for no reason in the world, but just the look of him, I suppose, his eyes and the silly cap. If anyone had looked in the window, they would have said, "Look at that old lady, on her own in there, half daft, laughing away at nothing." Well then, they would have been wrong, ma'am, I said. What better could you have been doing? You were here, in your own world, happily laughing at your very own little clown. Do you want to go into town for a few hours? Take a break, Richard asked. I'll stay with Mam until you come back. I'd love to, I said. But no, there will be other Christmas Eves for shopping. Anyway, more snow is promised for later, and that would make it very difficult to get back out here. Yes, you could be right about that, said Richard. Actually, I think I might move Mam's bed over to the window, I said. It's really warm in here with the sun bouncing off the sea and the snow. We moved Mam's bed, her little clown standing steadfastly on the bed frame at the foot of the bed, his big red shiny shoes submerged in blue tack to secure him. I propped her up on her pillows so she could look out the window over the clown and the sea and into the azure blue sunlit sky. It was positively Mediterranean. I wonder would we take a walk on the beach, asked Mam, after Richard had left for home. It's a really lovely day, and there's great heat in that sun. Okay, I said, but we'll have a cuppa first. I did not want to burst her bubble by telling her that it was 4 degrees out there. And I knew that by the time we would have had the cuppa, she would have forgotten all about that walk on the beach. Dementia does that. Just then, an attendant popped her head in the door. I didn't know her. Everything okay? She asked. I'm Sally. I'll be on over Christmas. Some carol singers have just arrived downstairs if... Oh, you've moved to the bed. Hey, that's a good idea. She bounced across the room and stood beside Mam's bedside by the window. The view here is amazing, she said, smiling at Mam. You've got the best room in the entire nursing home. But Mam's eyelids had dropped. The heat and sunlight and silent night had lulled her to sleep. Sally tiptoed out of the room to join the ambulant patients downstairs with the carol singers. I sat at Mam's bedside, still in the light and heat. Just then I remembered that I had my sketch pad in my handbag on the press beside me. I opened my bag, took out my pad and brush pen, and started sketching to the strains of jingle bells and the seasonal smell of mince pies. 20 minutes later, he had almost materialized. Cap, wild hair, dicky bow, braces and baggy pants. All he needed now were his oversized shoes and one finishing touch. A magic stroke to make those soft eyes smile. Mission accomplished. Seconds later, Mam awoke. Hazy and slightly dazed by the sunlight, she lifted her eyes to meet mine. Look, I said, holding my sketch up for inspection. Who is this? Ah, she sighed, smiling, giving a gentle nod to the little man at the foot of her bed. That's my little clown. Mam passed away peacefully 5 days later.
It couldn't be Christmas without my little clown.
Thanks.
Can I tell you a little funny story? It's very short about a clown.
Yes, I never get tired listening to it, Nollaig.
It's a tiny little one. Yes,
my second eldest.
My second eldest son said he wanted us to meet his girlfriend. And I had always told them, don't bring somebody home until it's the one, because I do not want to see every girl you're ever going out with. Anyway, he arrived. He said she'll be here soon. So we said, fine, that's grand. Nice to meet her. And she arrived at the door. He said, now I have to warn you, Mum, she's a clown. And I said, yeah, sure, I'm a bit of a clown myself. And anyway, 5 minutes later, she knocked on the door and I opened the door and there she was in full clown regalia. As she was going through college, she worked as a clown to supplement her income. And she traveled on the bus in the full clown outfit. You should have seen the face of my husband when he saw her. He thought that Stephen had lost.
Oh, that's a great story, Alice.
Yeah. They are married, they have three children, and they are very, very happy.
No more clowning around.
Okay, there's one other poem that the author isn't here tonight, but it's one that registered with me as being a particularly memorable Christmas poem, and it's from Anne McManus, and it's called Childhood Memory.
His glassy eyes, his hairy hump, his lumpy feet, his thick, curled lips made my childhood Christmas. One camel between the three. Did they take turns, the magi, or toss a coin? I longed to get into his saddle, grasp the embroidered reins in my 10-year-old hands. That year, on a quiet January day, I stole out of our bright kitchen into the nearby dim cathedral, climbed into the leather saddle, and rode that camel to the Orient.
I can just picture Anne McManus.
I can see Anne doing it.
Yeah. All right, well, listen, we've passed, I know, we've passed the 9 o'clock mark, and we've come to the end of, more or less, of our festivities. Thanks to everybody for putting in stories, poems, and other bits of regalia. And we're going, somebody want to say something there? No, sorry. Okay, we're going to finish up with another song then, and this time it is. It's Mary Rose again with a Christmas song, and with her family Peter, who's a renowned musician around Galway and elsewhere. And this is a Christmas song to get us all out in good cheer. Okay.
Thanks, everybody, and thanks very much indeed. Lovely night. Yeah.
Thanks to everyone.
Night, everybody. Merry Christmas. I hope you all have a lovely time.
All right, we can Merry Christmas ourselves after this. Okay, here we go.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. Next year all our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. Next year all our troubles will be miles away. Once again, as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us will be near to us once more. Someday soon we all will be together. If the fates allow, until then we'll have to muddle through somehow. So have yourself a merry
gorgeous Mary Rose.
Very good. Very good.
Well done.
All right. Listen, thanks to everybody. Thanks again. That was our 17th session since Culture Night in September. So we've had 17 rounds of Right On. Mm-hmm. It passed very quickly, don't they?
Absolutely,
yeah. Our next Joanne and other people keep calling it a class. So our next term is January to Easter, and then Easter to summer. So if you want to call it a class, that's it. We'll be gathering again on the 11th. It's an easy one to remember. The 11th of the first, all the ones. The 11th of the first, which is the second Thursday, of January. So that's when we'll be coming back in the new year. All right. I hope everybody has a peaceful and a happy Christmas and a healthy Christmas. And we'll see you all back here on the 11th of the 1st.
Thank you, Frank, for all the
happy
work.
Happy Christmas, everyone. Happy Christmas, everyone. Looking forward to seeing you in the new year.
God bless and take care, everybody.
Yeah. Help yourself,
thank you
everyone.
For all the lovely songs and poems.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. God bless.
We wish you a Merry Christmas.